Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. And in our ongoing series on Nobel Prize winners, we're going to talk tonight about Kary Mullis, who died recently at the age of 74. Kary Mullis was awarded one half of the 1993 Nobel Prize in Chemistry, along with Michael Smith, for his invention of the polymerase chain reaction, or the PCR method. As described in NobelPrize.org, an organism's genome is stored inside DNA molecules, but analyzing this genetic information requires quite a large amount of DNA. In 1985, Kary Mullis invented the process known as polymerase chain reaction, PCR, in which a small amount of DNA can be copied in large quantities over a short period of time. By applying heat, the DNA molecule's two strands are separated, and the DNA building blocks that have been added are bonded to each strand. With the help of the enzyme DNA polymerase, new DNA chains are formed, and the process can then be repeated. PCR has been of major importance in both medical research and forensic science. So this is one of those Nobel Prize discoveries that I understand. Basically, what Mullis was able to do was break up DNA and recreate small parts of it many, many times over, so it could be used to identify the genetics of an organism. Sometimes that organism was a human being, sometimes that organism was a bacterium. Essentially, you heat the DNA to break bonds, you cool it, you then heat it up a little less and recreate the bonds, and you can do this many, many times over. Here's a brief description of polymerase chain reaction.
A sample of chromosomal DNA, also called genomic DNA, can be used as the starting material for the polymerase chain reaction, or PCR. With PCR, an investigator can amplify a single copy of a DNA segment into billions of identical copies. In addition to the target DNA, a PCR reaction contains several other ingredients. These include free nucleotides, DNA primers, and the enzyme TAP polymerase. The primers are typically about 20 nucleotides long and are complementary in sequence to the ends of the target DNA. TAP polymerase is derived from hot springs bacteria and can tolerate the intense heat of a PCR reaction. A PCR reaction lasts several hours and typically consists of 20 to 35 repeating cycles. A cycle begins by heating the reaction mixture to 95 degrees Celsius. The heat denatures the DNA, breaking the hydrogen bonds that hold the strands together. After denaturing the DNA, the temperature is reduced to around 60 degrees so that the primers can form hydrogen bonds, or anneal, with their complementary sequences in the target DNA. Note that the primers and the target DNA follow base pairing rules. An adenine, A, pairs with a thymine, T, and a cytosine, C, pairs with a guanine, G. In the next phase, the temperature is raised to 72 degrees Celsius. TAP polymerase functions optimally at this temperature and begins polymerization, adding nucleotides to the 3' end of each primer attached to the DNA strand. After one complete cycle, there are two double-stranded copies of the target DNA. The PCR reaction mixture contains many copies of the primers and an abundant supply of nucleotides to perform many additional cycles. After a second cycle, there are four copies of the target DNA. After cycle three is finished, there are eight copies of the double-stranded target DNA sequence. Note that only two of the double-stranded copies consist of just the target fragment. The others also include flanking DNA regions. As the number of cycles increases, the products consist of a greater proportion of fragments with just the target DNA. After four cycles, half of the fragments consist of just target DNA, and half of the fragments also contain flanking DNA. With each additional cycle, the number of copies of our target sequence doubles. At the end of cycle 25, there are more than 33 million copies of this double-stranded target region.
Well, Kary Mullis was born in eastern North Carolina in Lenoir, which is only a couple of miles from where my daughter-in-law grew up, in the Boone Blowing Rock area. Very pretty country up there. That's where my son and daughter-in-law got married. He studied chemistry at Georgia Tech. Then in his 20s, in 1966, he moved out to Berkeley. Berkeley in 1966, what was going on out there? Well, you can be sure the counterculture was going on, and he became a counterculture dude, not your typical Nobel laureate. He got his PhD there in biochemistry. Besides the counterculture and politics, biotechnology was also exploding, and he became a consultant. And it took some years before he figured out the PCR. But it came to him in an aha moment in his car, and here he describes it in his Nobel interview.
Well, it was, you know, it was typical of interesting development in that I was looking for something else. PCR was the possible outcome of a solution to a hypothetical problem that didn't really exist. I mean, I was working on trying to sequence a single base pair, you know, what they call SNPs today, single nucleotide polymorphism, because those were medically important. And I was trying to do it with oligonucleotides because I ran a lab that made them, and we had really improved the efficiency with which we made them over the 3 or 4 years prior, so that we could make them a lot faster than the company, Cetus, that I worked for, could use them. Okay. I had 7 people working for me, and I was thinking, well, I'm either going to have to cut the staff down to like about 3, because now we've got these little automated devices that'll do it, or I'm going to have to increase the demand for oligonucleotides. So I started thinking of what else can you do with them, and I thought it's possible that you can make a rapid clinical assay for single base polymorphism. Like sickle cell anemia was a good example. I had people there. That took, back then, maybe you go into a clinic and they take a sample and maybe 3 weeks later you'd know, which is a lot of agonizing. Kind of. Mm. I thought, you know, it'd be nice to have that in one shift in the hospital, kind of, and they'd let you know. And I thought oligonucleotides maybe were the answer there, but I was a chemist. I still am a chemist. And I really didn't have an appreciation for the hugeness of the human genome compared to, say, a 5,000 base pair plasmid that I was using as a sort of a model system. And I was thinking of this method that would require a couple of oligonucleotides. One of them would sort of be a control, but they would be pointed right toward each other, just like in a PCR reaction. And then I was thinking of how I'm going to get rid of excess deoxynucleotide triphosphates or something like that. There was a couple of technical problems I was trying to solve, and one of them, the way I decided to solve it was to like run a sort of sham reaction first with the oligonucleotides in place and the sample, and then add my radioactive tracers and stuff and run it again. And because it was going to use up it was just not for the idea at first of like duplicating the signal, but then I realized the side effect of that was going to be that I was going to double the signal if there were enough like deoxynucleotides available. I was trying to get rid of those if there were any coming in with the sample.
But you were out driving. You had this in your head and you were thinking about it constantly, and then you just realized that there was a way.
You don't think in the lab as much, you know. Yeah. I usually think, I was spending my weekends up in Mendocino at a little cabin, and I would drive up every Friday night and come back on Sunday night. And that's really, that was a nice, it was about 2.5 hours. And it's sort of you've got something to do with your hands, and you can't do anything else. So you think that's when I did most of my thinking, actually, because the day-to-day life in a laboratory doesn't allow a lot of, you know, there's all these letters in your inbox, and there's your phone ringing, and there's all these people that you have to deal with and stuff, and you don't have really that kind of time.
Well, PCR is used a lot in forensic medicine these days. Also used a lot in microbiology. It's revolutionized our ability to culture organisms. In the old days, we used to use agar plates and have them grow out, and it took time. Now we simply look at the organism's DNA. Here's Kary Mullis to talk a little bit about that and winning the Nobel Prize.
Polymerase chain reaction, or PCR, is an invention I had in about 82, 83. It's a way that you can produce a little teeny piece of DNA, a specific one, out of the whole genome, and make as many copies of it as you wanted to, and there's no limit. Basically, it's a matter of putting together the trinucleoside phosphates, the things that the body would use in making new DNA. And you put in these two little things called oligonucleotides, which are like little single-stranded pieces of DNA. They're sort of pointing at it chemically, and they're saying, you, this sequence. Make a copy of yourself. Every time, basically, that I heat and cool this solution, go to that little spot and double it. It solves the two major problems in DNA chemistry, which was specificity and amount. In 75, people had just discovered this molecular cloning, where you could isolate a DNA sequence and you could put it in a bacteria and you could make more and more and more of it. People thought about cloning as almost a miracle, but it took a long time. It would take a lab like mine, say, 6 months probably. It was such a neat, new, and exciting and spooky thing that nobody was looking for a quick way to do it. People thought, well, we're going to have to get along with the fact that DNA is a very vital thing that we all want to know about. You have a lot of it in total, but any one part of it, you'll never have enough to make it convenient to study. I was driving to Mendocino in the middle of the night. I was just cruising along in my patterns of thought. And out of that, the concept of PCR became just obvious to me. It was something I already knew how to do in my lab. The matter of heating and cooling a tube, you know. The first notion I had was just stop. And I stopped right in the middle of the road. And I said, wait a minute, somebody's going to come along here and hit you. And I wrote with a gas receipt that I had in my glove compartment, wrote on that. And it was just so ridiculously simple that it took me a long time to really say, this would actually work. The next morning, fairly early, I went out to Jack's Valley store and bought a couple of bottles of red wine and drank them before I could go to sleep. It was a joyous kind of feeling, but it was also, I just doubted that it really would work. It's got to be, any minute now I'm going to see what the problem is here. At that point, genetic diseases were starting to be discovered. We knew that there was an awful lot of information in every one of your cells. It was real obvious that we wanted that information, and PCR made that possible in an incredibly simple format. Do you ever watch Cop Show? And you know that they use DNA to trace somebody and say who was here or who killed this person. All that stuff is first PCR, then you do the DNA analysis. The Nobel Prize came 10 years after the PCR was invented. It was a phone call one morning, you know, early in the morning, and I thought somebody was joking. It's an awesome thing. I probably was too young to really appreciate the awesomeness of it, but it was fun. They know how to put on a show. My mother came up to the front of the auditorium and like hugged me. She definitely was moved by the fact that one of her boys had got the Nobel Prize. You know, I didn't think of myself prior to that as really caring all that much about what the world thought of me, but that they thought about me in that way, I sort of think, maybe I do care. I mean, that probably was unexpected. It gives you the feeling, if you ever feel bad for any other reason, you go, oh, at least I got the Nobel Prize. Nothing will completely destroy my self-worth feelings. That sort of creeps up on you after 20 years or so, that, you know, you think of yourself as a Nobel Prize winner. It makes a difference. I don't think I know anybody who got one that wasn't really affected.
Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT genius, Sid Tapps. Kary Mullis made quite a name for himself outside of the Nobel Prize. He was asked by the defense to be an expert witness at the O.J. Simpson trial, but they withdrew that when the prosecutor said, well, we'll bring up some of his more counterculture habits, if you catch my drift. The movie Jurassic Park was actually based on his PCR concept. In the novel, which is based on Michael Crichton, figures out that if you can take a little bit of dinosaur DNA, you can recreate a whole dinosaur. And Kary Mullis was also sort of controversial because he was one of the people who did not believe that HIV was the cause of AIDS. So as I said before, he was one of our most colorful Nobel laureates, not in the Feynman category, but probably one step below him. As he said, he celebrated his PCR discovery with a glass of red wine. So as a final tribute to Kary Mullis, I think we'll play the song that Bob Marley made famous, but it was actually written by Neil Diamond, who sang it first, and we're going to play the original, Red, Red Wine.
Red, red wine, go to my head, make me forget that I still need a soul. red, red wine.